Today I want to talk about KJ Costello, Jamie Newman, and big-time grad transfers that could make a dent in this 2020 college football season and all that's coming up after the bumper.
Don't be cornering me. Hold up. Time. You gotta help me with that corner sh**.
What's up, kinfolk? It's RJ Young. I am not on a step mill. Consider hitting the like and subscribe button because I upload a video every single day. It's always college football related, sports related. We have a good time today. I want to talk about KJ Costello and Jamie Newman as guys that could make a dent in the SEC and what I think is going to be a top-heavy quarterback season for the SEC. I don't expect a whole hell of a lot out of Bo Nix after what I saw last year, although he could make the jump. And I don't expect a lot out of Ryan Helinski after last year, though he did get a win in air quotes against Georgia because it was really about Georgia not playing Georgia football, but also about Will Muschamp's defense setting up and really showing us all what South Carolina is going to be about, which is hitting people with this big rock and daring you to try to beat them with your offense. And that's one of the reasons why we think that Kirby Smart has gone away from murder ball to what we think is going to be an air it out kind of offense that can score and also can lead you in comeback wins. This is one of the reasons why getting Jamie Newman was a parting gift for James Coley to give to Kirby Smart, as that quarterback room went from looking like it didn't have a whole lot, or at least was going to have to depend on either one, a redshirt freshman in Carson Beck, or a project quarterback in Dwan Mathis. And now you have Jamie Newman, and if JT Daniels gets a waiver to play this year, you'll have two guys that have shown, at the very least, that they can play Power 5 football and can lead you toward wins. But I think Jamie Newman was always going to be the guy. I call him store brand Cam Newton because that's who he is. He can go get you a bucket on third and long. He can tuck it and go get you a first down. He can also complete those passes down the field. And with George Pickens out there and really that bevy of running backs that they have, like Zamir White, Kendall Milton, Kenny McIntosh, James Cook, you're going to have options here. You're going to be able to leave Dejan Edwards on the shelf. For Georgia, it's going to be about the offensive line and whether or not they really got to throw Broderick Jones into the fire right away. As talented as he is, not sure that he's talented to do it this early in his career. You're also going to need to figure out which one of these guys can go catch passes whose name is not George Pickens, because when you looked at how many passes Jake Fromm threw last year, and it wasn't a lot, 49 of the catches went to George Pickens. Combined across the rest of the wide receiving core, we're talking about 40 catches. That includes Dominic Blaylock, who left the season with an ACL injury. He could be back in time for the start of the season, but you never know. Same thing with Master Teague up at Ohio State. I think that Jamie Newman is going to have to carry this offense in a way that he had to carry, really, Wake Forest. I mean, he had Sage Surratt and not a whole lot else to depend on there, but this isn't going to be any different than what he had, except he's going to have a better defense. He's probably going to have a better play caller in Todd Monken, even if neither one of them understands what exactly it is that they're getting into with this thing called SEC football, even in the SEC East. In the SEC West, KJ Costello is going to assume the reins as the transfer quarterback to Mississippi State and play in Mike Leach's air raid offense, which is really simple and turns every single offensive play into a math problem. We're going to flood the field with more wide receivers and more pass catchers than you can man up against, and we're going to try to use your over-aggressiveness against you and take advantage of that. I think KJ Costello also has tremendous NFL pedigree because he is a massive human being and he has that size that we know that the NFL likes, but also he's giving these sorts of Jacoby Brissett and Phillip Rivers kinds of vibes. You could see him having an outstanding season and vaulted into the first round. I believe he's in some mock drafts already as a first round quarterback. I don't know if that's because quarterback has so much value associated with it or because he's just that good, but we'll find out for sure. And he's not even going to be the best player on his team. That's going to be Kylan Hill. If Kylan Hill is used the way that Matt Borhe was used at Washington State, where that dude had 817 yards rushing on 127 carries and then 86 catches for like 597 yards, you could see what they're going to be. I mean, Kylan Hill was a 1,300-yard back for Joe Moorhead last year. I expect him to be a big part of the offense, and he and Costello could form a partnership that is really great. And if they have anything like the kind of athletes that we're used to seeing coming out of Mississippi State, they could be special. You got to remember that this place continues to put out guy after guy after guy. We're just not really paying attention to Mississippi State like that because they don't win 10 games every year. But in that area, if Mike Leach can recruit and his staff can recruit, they're going to be good. As for the two of them, I expect Jamie Newman to have the better season on the football field, but KJ Costello might get the better grade, and we'll have to wait how that sees or see how that goes. The other guy that I want you to keep your eye on is Chase Brice. I understand that for many of us, we kind of put him out of sight, out of mind. This is a guy that's backing up Trevor Lawrence, came in for a couple of games, went to Dabo Swinney and said, "Coach, I know I'm not going to play, so can we engineer a transfer?" And Dabo helped him get to Duke. Now he's going to be under the tutelage of David Cutcliffe, and we know that Cutcliffe is really a great quarterback's coach in addition to being a head coach, offensive coordinator, and what he was able to do with Eli Manning really put him on the map for the rest of us, and everybody who's come through has done well. Remember, Daniel Jones came out of Duke as a first-round draft pick that the New York Giants decided they had to have, and then you get this Danny Milktoast out here. Y'all call him Danny Dimes. I call him Danny Milktoast, dropping real gems in his first season as the quarterback for the New York Giants. So if Chase Brice can develop the tools that he already has, there's no reason to believe that he can't be an outstanding quarterback. Of course, that's in the ACC. That's not in the SEC. And that's really the three that I'm going to be watching in as far as we talk about grad transfers and particularly at the quarterback position, because we didn't see a whole lot of movement, but we saw some. I know De'Aaron King is down at Miami. That's definitely going to be a guy that we're all watching because we know what he was capable of doing 2 years ago when he was passing for 3,000 and rushing for 1,000 and was the offense for Houston. Now Rhett Lashley gets a hold of him. You saw what Rhett Lashley was able to do with Shane Buechele and SMU, leading them to their best season since like 1984, back when the Pony Express was still a thing and Barry Switzer was still running Wishbone and Bo Jackson was running all over SEC defenses. That's how long ago that was. If Rhett Lashley can get this thing going offensively, and if Manny Diaz and that defense can get that thing going defensively, I know that we're all going to be watching Gregory Rousseau, because that dude's coming off of like 16 sacks last year. Miami could be good, but we always think Miami could be good, kind of like we think Texas could be good, except Miami gets sunned by La Tech in the walk-on Independence Bowl. And how am I going to talk well about a team from Miami that gets beat down in a bowl game named after a local bar by a team from Ruston? I can't get behind all of that, man. Y'all going to have to go show me. Y'all going to have to do something like, I don't know, win 10, 12 games before we start talking about it. 12 is, yes, that's a lot. But if you go win 10 games, Miami, we'll have more things to say about you other than how you should really put away your turnover chain. All right, that's it for me. Doses.